Beginning on December 9th, the U.S.-led Global Democracy Summit was held, and Biden took on the appearance of the headman of the democratic world. In fact, when Bill Clinton took office as the U.S. president in January 1993, he notably declared that the United States was the oldest democracy in the world. On Constitution Day in the year 2000, Clinton once again praised the founding fathers of the United States who signed the Constitution for working hard to create a democracy. Does the United States really have democratic traditions? 200 years ago, the U.S. Constitution was born at the Constitutional Convention in 1787. The founding fathers gathered in Philadelphia and their words would leave one amazed. They ought to be so constituted as to protect the minority of the opulent against the majority. Your people is a group beast. The minority should therefore enjoy a more permanent and conspicuous station in whatever concerns the government. The evils we experience flow from the excess of democracy. This is the mainstream voice at the Constitutional Convention in Philadelphia, a grand anti-democratic gathering to create America's Constitution, which has not a single mention of democracy. It is very different from today, and there is absolutely no democratic government in the inauguration speech of either George Washington or John Adams. The founding fathers of the United States are not alone. Democracy, now a common value of humanity, was regarded as something bad most of the time, for millennia since it appeared. The ancient Greek philosophers Plato and Aristotle introduced the concept of democracy, regarding the democratic regime as the worst choice. The Italian city-state republic in the Middle Ages also believed that democracy must result in tyranny. Even in the age of Enlightenment, when popular sovereignty and political equality were brought to the table by the bourgeoisie, most people were still hostile towards democracy. The future of mankind must never be controlled by the majority. Democracy is one illegitimate form of government. This is not difficult to understand. Democracy, as a concept, is a common value of humanity. People everywhere have a desire to become the master of their country and participate in political governance on equal footing. But for thousands of years, human beings were living class societies, where the majority were ruled by the elite minority. How can one not regard democracy as a scourge? Since the advent of the era of the capitalism, social elites have paid much more attention to private property than before, so they embraced freedom enthusiastically to expand and protect private wealth. Democracy often threatens the freedom of the bourgeoisie. This is why the founding fathers adamantly refused a democratic country. It is too dangerous for private ownership. Alexis de Tocqueville, a French political thinker who wrote Democracy in America, is a typical liberal. He said, "I despise and fear the crowd. I passionately love liberty, legality, respect for rights, but not democracy." But the working class, which was growing with capitalism, did not agree. What they desire is exactly what the bourgeoisie feared. The first economic crisis of the capitalist world broke out in Britain in 1825. After that, labor movements began to rise widely. The three major labor movements in Europe in the 1930s and 1940s, the European revolutions of 1984, and Marx's theory of scientific socialism emerged in succession. The first step in the revolution by the working class is to raise the proletariat to the position of ruling class to win the battle for democracy. This caused the capitalist countries at the time to fall into a legitimation crisis. The bourgeoisie were the minority. How could the bourgeois elites in power represent the popular sovereignty of the proletariat? For nearly 100 years since the first half of the 19th century, the binding relationship between democracy and socialism was natural. Because socialism has achieved the rule of the proletariat and its democratic nature is self-evident. Until 1916, the relation between socialism and democracy would have seemed quite obvious to most people. Socialism and democracy are inseparable. Socialists claim to be the only true democrats, never to be confused with the bourgeois clique. Either a socialist revolution takes place where the proletariat seizes power, or the proletariat surrenders further political rights within the capitalist system. For the capitalist world, it's not difficult to choose between the two. With regard to the universal suffrage, which was a main appeal to the labor movements, the capitalist countries had to gradually make compromises from the initial bloody suppression or complete rejection. The West did have elections at that time, but they were only a right held by the aristocratic minority. In the early 19th century, the United Kingdom required an annual income of more than £20 for anyone to have the right to vote. Back then, the average daily salary of British workers was only 2 or 3 pence. Of the entire population of over 30 million, only several 10,000 had a vote. In the United States, black slaves were initially counted as 3/5 of a person. Women had no votes before 1920, and Indians had no votes before 1924. It is not difficult to see that for the masses of the people in a capitalist society, universal suffrage is only the most preliminary and superficial aspect of democratic aspirations, and the people's ultimate goal is to truly become the master of their own country. However, the Western capitalist world, with the United States being a typical example, has begun to seize the power of interpreting democracy. They see the people's democratic demands in the ballot. Once the voting period is complete, the democracy of the masses goes dormant. The people will no longer have anything to do with political decision-making, management, or supervision, let alone immediate accountability. This is the American democracy that people are most familiar with today, also known as liberal democracy. It equates votes with democracy. Election is not necessarily related to democracy. In ancient Greece, elections were an institutional arrangement of aristocratic governance, and democracy manifested as the drawing of laws. Even the church in the Dark Middle Ages has elections eternally, so how was the vote hooked up with democracy? Modern theoretical scholars in the West first tell you that it is impossible for the masses to participate in political governance. Elitism is inevitable. That is to say, if you enforce socialism, you are not automatically tied to democracy, and even if I am a bourgeois elite, I can still have democratic legitimacy. What is legitimacy? Western theorists went on to invent that legitimacy is votes. American-Austrian economist Joseph Schumpeter wrote in the 1930s and published the book Capitalism, Socialism, and Democracy in 1942. It officially replaced substantial democracy with formal democracy. Schumpeter redefines democracy as the political method. The principle of democracy then merely means that the reign of government should be handed to those who command more support than do any of the competing individuals or teams. The elites become the candidates in an election, and the people are only responsible for choosing a candidate among the elites. Democracy has changed from sovereignty of the people to way of selecting leaders. Its primary task is to elect those who have decision-making powers. This equates elections with democracy. A political system is democratic as long as its elections are conducted in a way to win people's votes. Otherwise, it is not democratic. Getting more votes gives you the legitimacy of democracy, which is a simply incredible deal for the capitalist regime. There is no need for good political performance, for long-term verification of democratic effectiveness, or to satisfy the true demands of the public opinions. Democracy has finally been tamed into a harmless thing in the West, and the bourgeoisie no longer have to worry that democracy will threaten their economic freedom. On the contrary, the West even bound economic freedom with political democracy, which used to have fierce conflicts with each other. This concept was introduced in the 1980s by Giovanni Sartori as liberal democracy in the book The Theory of Democracy Revisited. More deceptively, liberal democracy is sometimes simply referred to as democracy. When we talk about democracy, sometimes we refer to liberal democracy and sometimes only democracy. On the first occasion, democracy is endowed with all the characteristics of liberalism, so the idea of democracy is embodied as an idea of freedom. On the second occasion, liberalism and democracy are separated, and the result is that the idea of democracy returns to equality. This completely refuses people's perceptions of substantive democracy and formal democracy. Sartori referred to liberal democracy as the mainstream democratic theory. Following America's victory of the Cold War, mainstream democracy almost became the only democracy, and the theory of liberal democracy monopolizes the interpretation of democracy. In 1989, Francis Fukuyama wrote the famous The End of History, Liberal Democracy is the End Point of Mankind, Ideological Evolution and the Final Form of Human Government, and the idea of liberal democracy could not be proved on. After the end of history, all other democratic theories and practices would be regarded as heretics, and the achievements of democratic development by different civilizations and systems would also be taken by American liberal democracy. Only less than a century ago, American democracy seemed to have already dominated the unruly world. Although democracy is the common value of humanity, the contemporary democratic theory is much too undemocratic. Even America's European allies are increasingly disagreeing with this kind of hegemonic monism of democracy. Even Britain's conservative publisher, The Economist, comment, America's democracy has become a clear-priced commodity. On the eve of the so-called Democracy Summit, European media EU Observer published an article accusing American democracy of the simplistic US and them narrative. What's more, the falseness of American democracy is increasingly reflected in real politics. For example, the worsening competence of candidates for the US presidential election. You can see Trump lost public support for his failed prevention and control for the pandemic. However, Biden administration, elected by the American people with pre-existing vaccine supplies, has witnessed more COVID deaths than the previous year. But was any important official in the two governments held accountable for their failed prevention and control? You can have elections, but you can't have anyone that represents public opinion. After casting out the Democratic vote, however, the policies turn out to be, the voters can only watch. Perhaps the only thing we can do is to wait another 4 years for the next vote. Can this really be called democracy?